So they're quite, there's quite a lot of design work going into the sailboards. Obviously, they're a formula board style board. You can see the harness lines there and shot on that boom, and they're adjustable. So you want them nice and long. So the longer you have them, the more you can stand your rig up. The mast is carbon fibre. They have at the battens around the boom there, the one just below the boom and the one just above, two what we call camber inducers. And a camber inducer is a rotating plastic device that presses onto the batten to lock in the depth or the curve. It's to make it like an aerodynamic wing shape. So it's been around for a long while now. And so the creation of those camber inducers has an advantage. It provides a nice aerodynamic shape. But in really, really light winds, let me start again. It has a nice aerodynamic shape, but also a very solid structural shape. So in really strong winds, it's a fantastic device, but in really light winds, you want a softer, supple sail. And so the cambers actually work against you and the stiff battens. So these sails actually perform better as the wind goes up the wind range. And that's one thing the sailors have to work around. And that's why they pump so much, to try and get it up to that wind range and actually really get into the most beneficial sort of speed that they're looking for.
Well, you mentioned pumping, and we reckon we're going to get plenty of it today. It's quite an exhausting thing to be doing all the way around the course. This is it.
It's not the most elegant looking methodology. So they're fanning the sail. He just adjusted his mast track back during that shot, so he was just about to come onto the plane. So it's not the most elegant looking thing, but they're fanning the sail, trying to create their own wind. So the faster the board moves through the air, it starts to create its own apparent wind. Apparent wind is what you actually sail in. It's a combination of the true wind and the wind you create by moving forward. And the faster you go, the more you can utilise that apparent wind. And so the skill is making that and creating that. And that's what we're looking at when they do pump.
If you've been watching our coverage over the last week or so from the World Championships and watching the different classes, I think it becomes obvious that different classes have different body shapes.
Yeah.
And different physical needs.
Definitely.
And a lot of core strength and long arms is what's needed for the RSX.
Yeah, and I think also a big heart. These guys are, yeah, really, really fit. You can see they're really lean. You can really see their muscles on their arms, especially in these light conditions.
Mattia Camboni of Italy, sitting fourth overall at the moment.
As Jordan was explaining it, they need to do a lot of pumping. And in order to do that, you really need to have good aerobic capacity. And they're training a lot on the water, doing the pumping, and also doing a lot of exercise on the bike or on the rowing machine to stay fit and to improve in that area.
And long and lean, what you said,
yeah.
Alec. It pays to be tall. Generally, in most, it's always better to be taller than short, I think, in our sport. But, yeah, it's very weight conscious.
Yeah, I think the body weight is between 70 and 76 kilos for these windsurfers. So, yeah, depending a little bit on how tall you are, you need to lose or gain weight. So
it's tough, isn't it? Because generally they're tall and they're strong, but they've got to be light.
Correct. And we'll see that. Even I was talking about it before the coverage, the transition to getting on the plane, the lighter you are today, the better it'll be, the easier and quicker you get onto that plane. So the planing is when you come up onto the bow wave and you actually sit on that like a speedboat does. That's what planing is. So that's going to be one of the majors. Port end of the line is just slightly advantaged at the moment, 20 metres. So we'll probably see the boats come down this end of the line. The boards.
So have they moved the start line?
I didn't really see them move the start line. I had the feeling the wind was a little bit to the right just earlier on, but it's coming a little bit back to the left actually now to a 40-meter advantage. But it seems like the majority is still choosing to start here at the boat end. You might see...
I think what has happened, from just going through the analytics, my friend, is that it looks to me like that top mark has been brought back closer. They've actually shortened the course slightly. So it was over, it was just at a kilometre now. It looks like it's just on 800 metres is what's happened.
Well, a bit more of a spread on the line. And our leaders pretty much sitting together at the pin end of the line, I think.
No, yep. Here. Spreading, that should start charging.
They're over here on the right-hand side as we look at it. So that's Pavel Tarnowski, the leader.
Yeah.
And Dorian van Rysselberghe right behind him.
It's pretty even there.
On the leaderboard. So Gold Fleet gets underway in the RSX Men here in Aarhus. A second attempt at the start. And they flap, flap, flap as they accelerate off the line. And it's an all clear from the race officials. So we are underway. We are racing here in Aarhus today.
They are really, really giving it their all at the moment. It's crucial to have a good line after the start and to have your own free wind so you can go at maximum speed. And we see some of them are tacking because they're a little bit caught up in the mix and in a bad position, so tacking out to the right. And yeah, they're also trying to minimize the tacks, I would say, because it's costing them a lot of meters. And let's see how it unfolds in this first upwind. From the analytics now, it looks like the left side is a little bit in front, but...
I'm just trying to catch somebody that's tacking so I can...
Well, such hard work at the start, isn't it, to accelerate away, trying to catch the wind in the sails, trying to...
get off that starting line in a good position.
Pump away 100%. Spanish coming this way, followed by the Chinese... But a good start all round. A clean start, and the men are away. Here's the fleet.
And yeah, you can already see they're pumping a little bit less than just at the moment of the start, and it's just, they cannot keep up with this maximum pumping during the entire race. So they need to have a good time management on when they are pumping more and when they're taking a short break. And obviously, the fitter you are, the longer you can pump and the faster that you will recover. So definitely the fitter guys have an advantage in these conditions.
It's a tough day at the office.
The Italian Daniela Benedetti going off to the left, whereas the two leaders overall, Tarnowski and van Rysselberghe, heading off to the right-hand side. And at the moment, the Italian is edging in front up there at the top of the screen.
So they're actually, you know, that for all their effort and work, some are starting to charge along, but mostly they're sitting around that sort of 4 to 5 knot range. Some are getting onto the plane, and you see it pop up on the analytics. You know, you can see they suddenly hit 7 knots. Israeli starting to show a little bit of speed. Look, there we go. You can see just top of the right of the screen there, one of them just jumping onto the plane with their pumping. So be looking for that pressure, any little gusts out on that course. There's a bunch of them coming to the right over here. It almost looks a little bit lighter just when we look out the window and try and spot them.
Yeah, it's hard to say. It looks pretty even to me. It's
got Tao Li of China, and just the other side of him, the Spanish sailor, Angel Grande Rock. Five French sailors in this fleet. We're just seeing Titouan Le Bosque moving up with that group.
I finally found I can see Bing Yi is not too far from the lead there, and I got his manoeuvre. Speed in 4.35, speed out 3 knots, so a loss of 1 and a bit knots, and manoeuvre loss of nearly 4 metres. So.
Yeah, I think it's starting to be interesting now. The group that went to the right just made a tech and they're on the right lay line. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that cross is going to go. The guys on the left are still continuing, maybe slowly starting to tech.
We're watching Yoav Cohen currently trying to make it... Well, challenging for the front there, just behind the Spaniard.
He has been finding speed, Yoav Cohen.
You can
I've been
see
watching
he's
him a lot. He's so light. Look at him. He's.
Yeah, it's easier in the light wind. When you are lighter, you can plane faster, but you have the disadvantage when there is stronger wind.
Today's a good day for him because he's doing 9 knots.
The Israeli needing every possible place position to move up the leaderboard. Currently sitting 31st, but right now, out in front, ahead of Goldfleet. This is the man in second, Ivan Lafuente of Spain.
Yeah, not much going on in terms of wind angle. It's very, very stable at around 140. So it's all about finding that right pressure and getting in that plane as fast as possible and keeping up the hard work.
Early days, though, as we make our way up this first leg. And very soon we'll be seeing the top mark coming into shot. You say that it's a shortened course.
Well, the course, when we first went to go, it was set just over a kilometre. This one's set at about 800 metres. So I'm not saying it's a short course. This course is the course. But it was shorter than what they originally were going to set it up as, I think is the best way to describe it. Again, I just got to say, Cohen, he's obviously, just physically looking at him on screen, he looks quite small. So he is managing to pop up onto the plane. He's off it there. He's dropped his speed there. Behind him, we'll see a fast charger coming up. The Spaniard, Glanderock, is going to come up into shot pretty soon. He's charging long. And they're overlaid on that mark, or is there... Yep. So it's a windward leeward 2 laps with a reach to the finish. Upwind, downwind.
Right now it's the young Yoav Cohen out in front, heading towards that top mark.
And a really good approach by him. I mean, he was on the right and he took the initiative to tack off and has... quite a good approach on that lay line, actually.
We saw Klejinski of Poland also coming in. So the Israeli edged his way in front and then at the midway stage took the lead. But it's not a big one. How's he going to sail it downwind? Can he hold on to that lead or can the European champion from Spain close him down? Mattia Camboni sitting fourth overall, round in third. Then comes the pole, Kuzinski and Lafuente of Spain. So two Spaniards in the top 5 right now. The Chinese, a strong windsurfing nation. 3 of them in the top 10, including the world champion, currently sitting in 9th. But that is our overall leader, Paweł Tarnowski of Poland. There we go. He's rounded in 17th. Tell you, Dorian van Rieselberger, who was sitting second overall, is 11th in this race. There you go, confirmation on the screen as well. But look at the lead now for Yoav Cohen. Seems to be pulling away.
Well, he's full planning.
He is going super fast.
Yeah. He's doing 15 knots and half the fleet are doing 8. Well done to him. Look at that. That's a great shot. That's an absolute great shot. It does, even I discussed it, you know, the lighter weight sailor is going to transition to planing before the slightly heavier sailor, so I'd have no chance today, Evie.
No, I agree with you on that.
We finally agree.
Yeah.
So he went, he did a bearaway set, went off initially and then jibed fairly early on. Wind has moved a little bit out to the right, so he's probably made the right call there. No real change in the pressure, pretty consistent, just around that 9 knots. So it's a happy day for him. Looks like he's just jibed back. And he'll be starting to charge in to that bottom mark line. So it's almost the same angles they sail upwind as downwind on the starboard course. And he's not going to quite lay into that bottom mark, so he'll be able to choose. And I'm guessing he'll sort of race across and then jibe, come in and go around the mark that was closest to the bottom of the screen when we saw that last shot of the course layout. What we'd call the right-hand mark as we look upwind. Good battle in the second and third spot.
Angol Grande Rock and Ivan Lafuente, the two Spaniards, fighting it out for third and fourth. Oh. So this is the leader. Sorry. That was Grande Rock of Spain. But look, our leader is already at the bottom mark.
Okay, so he's done exactly what I said he was going to do, just to make myself sound really good.
That's what it's all about, right?
You're all saying good, Jordan.
But that was that whole tactic I said. He went down and jibed to set up to come to this exact mark. And now he's just sort of...
taking a small break,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, that's exactly what it looks like, doesn't it?
Oh, well, it's all about timing your pumping sets in, and he has taking some breath, and then he will start pumping again.
He has a significant lead. The wind's starting to bend slightly left.
They have a busy day on the water as they continue to try and make the top 10 cut. This is race 7 for the championships, the first for Gold Fleet of the RSX men. They've got another couple of races scheduled for the day. So if you're out in front, I guess it's very sensible to spare yourself. Take a little breather. As Kleshinski in second is followed round the mark by Meng Fan Gao of China.
Good downwind run from...
That's a defending world champion, yeah. Bing Ye, with the number 12 sail for China. And the battle for third between the Spaniards has become a battle for fifth as the Chinese moved up nicely in that downwind.
They also managed to be on the plane down that run, and that certainly made a lot of difference for them.
Best placed Italian, Camboni, is round. This is our overall leader, or at least going into the race he was, Pavel Tarnowski.
Great comeback.
Yeah, he's made some...
gained eight places, nine places right, in the downwind.
The other thing to note, one, they're hitting the mark, which is allowed in windsurfing rules, just so people know. Two, you'll see that on these boards, unlike a normal formula board, they actually do have a centreboard. And in light winds, they will put the centreboard down, and you can actually see they're doing that as they come into that mark. They don't mind hitting the mark, do they, Evie?
No, they're allowed to, so yeah. They're just trying to pass it as close as possible.
As close as possible. Here we go, here's a potential.
Oh, he's really kissing the mark there.
So the other thing, you don't have a rudder on a sailboard. So when we've talked about boat dynamics, you steer a boat with your body weight and your sail trim and then your rudder, third. And so the sailboard has basically taken the rudder completely out of the equation. So you've only got your body weight and your sail trim. So that's effectively how you steer a sailboard, and that's where that comes from. So that's the perfect example of how it works.
Here's the front of the fleet, Yoav Cohen. Now, what a difference half a leg makes. We were talking about Cohen possibly even taking a breather earlier on. I think we're being a little bit flippant there. But Mengfeng Gao of China is back in the hunt and closing on the leader.
So it's quite awkward.
Yeah, he's not doing too much effort there.
Yeah, it is quite an awkward thing. What he's trying to do is steer the board with his feet. Now he's trying to get up to speed.
Yeah.
He's seen some pressure. I was just going to describe what his feet were doing, but it's a different situation now. He's trying to lock it in there.
So you can see he's standing a little bit on his toes.
Yeah.
Like almost he's trying to be as light as possible and, you know, try to feel the board as light as possible, keep it almost in the air.
Yeah. It's just gone into that, and you'll just see, you've got to watch the feet do a lot of work in because they're doing, and he's tacking again, so, okay. The feet do a lot of work with the steering, so that what Evie was talking about is exactly right. You've really got to be astute in the way you manage that board. It does look like he did try and come back on starboard but got knocked as he went, so he's come back out to the right-hand side. Can't be too far from getting to that lay line, Evie. He must be almost...
Yeah.
It's the Chinese sailor coming in, so
yeah,
Mengfeng Gao looking really good at the moment.
There's a little bit more pressure on that left side, I would say, and he's...
And the wind's just gone slightly back to the left, only slightly.
And he's fully on it, like...
He's doing 6.5 knots to Yoav Kaun at just around 4 knots.
Yeah.
It's amazing these analytics, we can just go, yep, let's find out exactly.
I have to say, the analytics often just confirm
what
Evie has already sensed and what you've seen out on the water.
Yeah, but today it's quite hard to see it on the water because it's stable, the wind isn't doing so much, so it's really about small changes, a little bit more pressure. It's just being able to plane or not, and those things definitely make the difference today.
Mengfeng Gao out in front. But can Yoav Cohen, the teenager from Israel, close the gap, regain his lead?
It's Beng Ye, I think, in shot, who was world champion last year. So Beng Ye, from memory, they've gone around that course, was just out on the...
Yeah, so the Chinese went to the left.
Right. Beng Ye was out on the right, from memory. On the bottom of shot.
But I'm talking about
Gao.
Yeah, Gao, who's in the front. Yeah.
I was just talking to who's in shot.
Yeah, the left side is definitely paying off. We also have Van Rijsselberger there at top of the screen, making a nice comeback.
This is a great game from Mengfeng Gao, managing to keep speed. So exactly what you're saying, Evie, there seems to be pressure out there. And it does look at looking out the window. There looks like there's more wind out there.
Yeah, it looks like a little bit of a gap here on the far right.
Gao going well as he approaches the top mark.
Yeah, and a 10-degree wind shift to the left also.
And he's increased the distance between himself and Cohen. And the rest of the fleet now falling behind as our leader from China really starts to take control of the race. Looking around, trying to decide as he approaches this mark how to deal with it. But we're seeing Dorian Van Rijsselberger making a good comeback. He's just outside the top five, and it'll be interesting to see at what position he is when he rounds this mark. Now let's get a good idea of just how far Yoav Cohen is back. We're seeing about 30 metres. But there, that time difference tells us everything we need to know. It's going to be a tough ask for the Israeli to get back into it. Former youth world champion Yoav Omer. So young, but already has plenty of youth experience. And he'll be pleased to even just be in Gold Fleet at this stage of the World Championships. Now then. Looks like Kleshinsky will be third, with the Spaniard Ivan Lafuente third.
And the wind continues to go left. So all the guys that went right, including Tarnowski, who had such a great downwind, has really, really made a big loss on the upwind. A little bit stuck on the right side.
No losses and only gains for Dorian van Rysselberghe in fifth, and has now moved away from the chasing sixth place Spaniard, Angel Grande Rock. And the Italian getting in on the inside. So we've got a place change there. I think that was Camboni. Defending world champion from China is away, just heading off the screen to the left-hand side there.
Yeah, so definitely all going to the top of the screen on the right side on the downwind, which makes sense because the left side definitely paid off in that upwind, so they're really trying to look for the good wind angle and a little bit more pressure out on that side.
That's our Chinese sailor, Min Fan Gao, coming back. He's the first to have jibed and head back to the centre of the course. He was looking down on speed to the opposition there for a while, but Cohen and the Polish sailor and the Spanish sailor are all starting to jibe now and come back, and it's definitely closed up behind. So this gap is quite significant for Gao. He's in cruise mode at the moment.
Well, he's working hard, yes. I would say.
Yeah.
I think these guys are just cruising
tactical
on the shore.
Cruise,
yeah.
Mate. Tactical cruise, mate.
Tactical cruise, mate. Yeah, he's in a nice lead. He's not going to give it away now. It's a 150-meter lead and looking quite fit and quite strong on that board, actually, really pumping.
Slow. There's the traditional job, and a very slow, just riding the wave down on that one. Just tried to do a little runner, so... Maybe just having a breather as part of that.
Catching his breath, yeah.
But the Chinese team, so strong and so dominant in recent years.
Especially in the light conditions, I would say.
Out on the water, we've got the defending world champion and the bronze medalist, both from China, from the last Worlds.
So I think our Polish sailor is starting to make a move here on this run. We've got a little bit of a split going on behind. So the Israeli sailor is trying to protect the majority of the fleet, and I think our Polish sailor has just gone down through the middle. So I'll be interested to see what happens out of that.
Well, the man with the yellow bib, Pavel Tarnowski, currently sitting in 15th. So he, as things stand, has dropped from the top of the leaderboard.
And so that means van Rysselberghe will be probably up there at the moment. You'd have to think he's doing a great job coming back from 11th, 13th he got down to the finish.
So the final short leg to the finish line for Meng Fan Gao of China. Bronze at the last World Championships, and his eye firmly on gold here in Aarhus. And this victory will do much to help him qualify for the medal race over the weekend. Currently sitting eighth overall. That's all going to change depending on the order of things behind him. So we've seen a thumbs up from Gao. He's a happy man. And the first race of the day goes to the Chinaman. Behind him, it looks like the pole. Klushinski is clear in second place. And then we've got the man who was doing so well earlier on in the lead. He's going to get himself a third place finish as things stand. But Klushinski, way out of the top 10 overall at the moment, finishes in second. In fact, the interesting thing is that Kleshinsky and this man, Yoav Cohen, are 33rd and 34th in the overall standings. But in this race, second goes to the pole and third goes to the teenager, former youth world champion from Israel, Yoav Cohen. Even La Fuente has been challenging in the front pack for all of the race, coming in fourth. And then, if the next guy is Dorian van Rysselberghe of the Netherlands, it'll be a finish that is likely to put him top of the overall standings. He's wearing the blue bib of the man who began the day in second, but if things go as they are doing, he will end the day with the yellow bib. So, the Dutchman in fifth. Camboni of Italy will have to satisfy himself with a sixth placed finish. Camboni's managed three second place finishes so far. And this is Louis Giard of France, one of the big names from the world of windsurf. Two victories to his name in these championships, but this time it's seventh for him. And right behind him is our defending world champion from China, just finished in eighth, Bing Ye. Matteo Sanz of Switzerland finishes his race in ninth for the Swiss. And Angel Van der Rock, the European champion, comes in 10th place. Pavel Tarnowski starts the day in the yellow bib and finishes well down the fleet. The pole has come in 15th place, which means he goes into the next race round about third overall. I think we ought to mention Louis Giard of France, because really he worked his way up the fleet. He was 33rd at the end of leg one and finished this race in seventh. So a remarkable comeback from him. Picked the shifts perfectly. Great technique. And the Frenchman ended up the best placed of a fleet of five in this gold fleet.
Yeah, he made up 15 places
on the downwind
run.
Yeah.
And when you go and look at it, he sailed further than most people, but he was averaging nearly two knots faster than most, except for Cohen. He had one of the fastest downwinds, so just looking at that. And then the other leg where he made up a lot of ground. I can just hunt for you. Giard. Then it was more scientific approach from there, piece by piece. Nothing major different on the next beat. And again, one of the fastest downwind on that final run. So, started to move through the fleet with speed.
person who's had a disastrous race is Daniele Benedetti of Italy, who started the day third overall. He was equal on points with his teammate Camboni, but he is way down the fleet, almost last. That's his red bib, and well, he had a bad start, was 36th at the top mark, and then went backwards, and is now currently sitting in 41st. Still keeps him in the top five overall, but he won't be pleased with that result at all.